not only are we looking at the body in static, but mostly we're looking at the body in movement. We're looking at the body in movement. And we're asking ourselves certain questions when the person is walking, right? We're looking at particular areas. Are these the only areas that we would ever look at? No. But these are just some of the greatest hits so that we can start to be able to read the body right off the bat so you can tell what's happening with your client when you have them walk. We're looking at several body areas when they're walking. We're looking at the talus, the calcaneus, the arches, the navicular, the knee joint, what's happening to the knee joint, if it's being supported. We're looking at the femur and rotation, what's happening to the muscle tissue around the femur and walking. Greater trochanter and the pelvis. We're looking to see what the greater trochanter does, what plane it moves in, right? We're looking at all of this from an articulation model and what other people would call the plane model. Spinal column. Did anybody look at Grachevetsky's chains and look up that YouTube video? Oh, you fell asleep to it? Looking at what's happening to the vertebrae and movement. The glenohumeral joint, what's happening to the GH joint and the arm and movement. Is it swinging? Is there movement in the arm? Is there movement just in the elbow? When we see people walk this way, you know, what's happening there? Is there internal rotation, external rotation? What part of the hands are we most seeing when they're walking? Are we seeing the back of their hand when they're walking? Are we seeing their palms when they're walking, right? Or are they pretty level out when they're walking? Lower arm, hands, and then head. What's happening to the head when they're walking? Are they looking down? Is it off to the side? Is it moving side to side? And what could that tell us about the muscles in the neck? Their gaze, we talked about their gaze. How is their gaze? How are they oriented? So you tell me, if someone is maybe looking more down towards the floor, do you think they may be more G or G prime? G. And if someone's up here in space, G prime. See, guys? And then we went through, we started to think about core differently. Does this resonate with anyone? We're looking at core, not just as a core power center, but as this whole core cylinder inside the body. Someone left a straw over there in the other room, but I thought that was kind of cool. Thank you for leaving the straw. You know, we can look at the core as this cylinder, and we can look at any change in that cylinder as a little scrunching of that core. You know, maybe there's something like this. Maybe there's this other pattern happening with core. So one of our objectives is to, what, fix a person or to give them an option? Give them an option. Give them length. As body workers, we lengthen, right? We can give them an option to do this. If you also have a Pilates background, you can lengthen and strengthen to be able to have this core now rise up. So we looked at all of these different body parts, body areas. We asked ourselves these questions and we had our partners, colleagues walk up and down and we pulled these things out. And then after that, is that the whole piece? No. After that, we verified our findings by hands-on, by assessing. Did most of you confirm your findings with body reading and then assessment? Did you see something and then when you went hands-on, you confirmed it? Like, oh, it actually makes sense. Good. We looked at talus. What is happening with the talus? What is happening with the navicular as we move the navicular up and down?
On the navicular, it was basically, I'm seeing in the notes that this says, is it moving too much, which means they're going to kind of be flat-footed in the medial arch?
Yes.
So when we were actually palpating the navicular yesterday, we were actually, it would have been a red flag if it was moving too much.
Right.
It's not moving at all.
Right. And when you were looking at Neil, his right navicular was moving a lot. And that was the one where you felt that it was
pushing up
at an angle.
Yeah.
Right. So in his case, do we want to add more movement to your navicular? No. We actually want to strengthen that right medial arch. So we looked at knee. We looked at tracking the knee. We did knee sleeve work right out of Art Briggs deep tissue. What's happening with the tissue? Where does it want to move? Where does it not want to move? And when we looked at Tiffany's knee, we had a clear indicator of restriction in one area that related to pain. Great, thank you, Tiffany. Would that always happen? Is that always going to be the case? No, not always the case, but it's great when it happens, especially in class. We palpated the tissue around the greater trochanter. Did that make sense to you guys? Taking the tissue clockwise and counterclockwise and sinking in. Remember, we have to sink in past superficial tissue. That superficial tissue is going to give you a different reading. So you have to go into that sinking, that deeper layer. When we went in your pelvis, we found that area of tightness, right? Spinal column, we checked again, clockwise, counterclockwise. Why? Why did I move the tissue clockwise and counterclockwise? Because of the contralateral movement, right? We're seeking to make these assessments parallel to what we do in movement, in walking. And finally, we started to check glenohumeral joint. Can the arm move anterior, posterior? And what does that mean with relation to the tissue that's happening around the shoulder girdle? Lower arm, we checked lower arm, and I gave you a different assessment for bicep. What's happening with bicep, and how can bicep then affect our bodies as we start thinking about different fixed points in space? How was that as far as a concept for you guys? Kind of tricky, huh? It's going to change your work for the better. And then head and neck, we started to palpate SCM. We'll go a little more into what's happening with suboccipitals a little later on in the week. But you got a sense of what might be happening in the back of the neck and how that may affect head tilt, forward head posture, and what have you. So, that's a quick review of yesterday. I know the second half still needs to work, but I want to give you an exercise, right? I want to give you an exercise before we start working. So everyone, go ahead and close your eyes. So I want you to imagine that you are a bag. Imagine you are a plastic bag. Moves around in space. And I want you to imagine this bag has limbs. You call them legs and arms, whatever you want to call them. They have limbs that move and are called to action whenever you seek to do something. Now, I want you to imagine that this bag has some areas inside it that are more solid than others. There are areas that feel pretty solid and other areas that don't feel as solid. And I want you to imagine this bag has no muscles and no bones. Not in what we think of it. Not in the way that we think of it. But just areas that are more solid and areas that are less solid. And I want you to imagine this bag in an area where you thought you had, bless you, where you thought you had pec muscle, or pectoralis major, minor, subclavius, brachioradialis, coracal brachialis. Imagine that doesn't exist. There is no distinction in this bag. And you call that area out to action, maybe bringing your hands together as some sort of butterfly exercise, butterfly, you know, weight exercise. But there is no pec major. There is just movement within the tissue of that bag. Now, go ahead and open your eyes. What did that feel like? What did you imagine? Imagine this area here that can just bring the hand together without thinking of a pec major, without thinking of a subclavius.
Smoother.
Smoother? Imagine, if you imagine there is no muscle, then what's there? What was there in that area that was less solid or was more solid? Fascia? Connective tissue? Great. body part. So here's the kicker, folks. Muscles are a construct of our mind. You know that the body doesn't believe it has, oh, I have a pec major. Oh, I have a bicep. I will use the bicep. When you do this, it doesn't think, contract bicep. Okay? Muscles are a construct. Gil Headley will point out to this and say, this doesn't exist. And I love that. And if you see some of these videos, so that doesn't really exist in the body. We have constructed it in our consciousness. You know, it's getting kind of hippie here, right? We have constructed it in our consciousness, our ego, whichever part, in order to create some sanity, right? But the body doesn't see that. So when we work, should we just work thinking, intending, just pec major? No. And we won't be doing that much this week, okay? We'll be intending more connective tissue and anything there. Does that mean that anatomy blows and you should never have to know it? No, not at all. Anatomy is awesome. There's a Rolfer by the name of Peter Melchior, who passed away several years ago, and he used to say, God helps those who know their anatomy. You don't like the word God, just stick in whatever you want to stick in. You know, Chick-fil-A, whatever. I don't know, whatever you want to think. So, if we start thinking of it that way instead of just muscle, then you're going to start to work differently. It's going to start to affect your work. You're going to maybe now work with respect to connective tissue. Right? If you start to move an arm, let's say, and think, hey, how can this be that bicep is pulling down instead of bicep pulling up, right? Well, if you stick just to the paradigm of bicep, yeah, that's going to confuse you. But if you change that paradigm and shift and think connective tissue can be pulling down, connective tissue can be pulling up, now it looks more like a possibility. Now that's changing your work, and guess what? Do people behave differently? Will people behave differently with their bodies? Absolutely. So now this whole other